music. Good morning, Bethany.
Morning.
From Luke 2, verses 10 and 11. And the angel said unto them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord." Let's stand together as we sing Joy to the World. How great our joy, and of course our theme is joy. When we get to the chorus part, this side of the sanctuary will sing "How great our joy," and then Eric's side will do the echo. All right, so just try to remember that a little bit, but if you mess it up, no big deal, because we're singing about joy. Let's sing together.
Joy, 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 joy,
together. good. Let's close with singing Noel together. In your precious name, amen. Please be seated.
Well, thank you so much for being here this morning at Bethany. It seems a little bit far away from Christmas, doesn't it? But this is Christmas Sunday, and so let me wish you a Merry Christmas. And God bless you. We are excited about the coming of Christ and the opportunity to continue to reflect on that this morning. And we want to do that as we have each week leading up to Christmas by spending a moment at the Advent candle. And so we've worked our way through different themes each week. And we've looked at the issue of hope. We've looked at peace. We've looked at love. We're looking at joy. And then this coming Friday evening, I'll mention this in a few moments, is our candlelight service. And we will look at the culmination of that, which is Christ. And so this morning, we're going to look at our next theme with a little video segment. And then following that, I'm going to invite Jean and Linda Wilbur to come up and to light the four colored Advent candles, the three purple and the one pink. And we reserve the white one, the Christ candle, for Christmas Eve. So hope you'll come back for that. But let's take a look at the video, if you would. And then Jean and Linda, if you'd light the candle following that, that would be wonderful. Thank you.
Few would have considered it a silent night, a holy night. Travelers jostled in the city gates. Weary fists pounded on closed doors, pleading on the outside, arguing from within, all to the same refrain, no room. Among the houses rang raucous Roman laughter, census takers with comfortable quarters and plenty of food and wine. There is little peace and less goodwill between stranger and villager here. Somewhere a dog barked, a lamb bleated, a woman moaned, and a baby cried. Out on the hillsides, exposed to the cold night, without even a stable for warmth, shepherds huddled around the fire, guarding their flocks against thieves and wolves. Suddenly, a light to split the darkness, a voice, a song, a chorus of angels. Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Unto you is born this day in the city of David, a child, a son, a shepherd, a king, a savior, which is Christ the Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace and goodwill to men. Awaken, O little town that cannot sleep. Hear the shepherd's words, the angel's message, and arise to a sound unfamiliar, the triumph of joy.
Thank you, Jean and Linda. Let me take this opportunity to welcome you here today to Bethany to this fourth Sunday of Advent. If you're here in person, it's so good to see each of you, and hope that when you came in, you received a program for you to use and to follow along with the service, as well as to be aware of the things happening this week. If you're joining us online, We hope that you received that and saw that information available by link, and encourage you to follow along with that. I want to take the opportunity now to dismiss our Kingdom Kids. And so, so Kingdom Kids, if you're here this morning, we're going to invite you to meet your teacher and leaders out in the commons, and they'll help you along. Good to see each of you as you head out and as you are joining us here this morning. A couple of announcements that I want to give. First, let me just start with some words of appreciation. Thank you to those of you who joined us after service on Sunday, last Sunday, to help transport the gifts from the Gardner Community Action over to Chair City Church. If you saw the email on Friday, those presents that you took over, as well as the wrapping that was done, met the needs of about 188 families in our community and the surrounding communities during this Christmas time. And so thank you for being a part of that, and the trips that you made back and forth. Those of you who loaned us your vehicles to use to be able to do that, thanks for caring for our community in that way. Want to also just say a word of thanks with regard to those of you who have been helping with the gifts for our adopted Waterford families. One of the things that's been interesting this year is that the three families that we were given are families that are all, if you would, at this point, grandparent-led. The children that we're helping and ministering to these families, these are children that are living with their grandparents, and their grandparents are taking care of them. And each year, we provide Bibles for them and the gospel, as well as those presents. And it's interesting. I shared with a couple people, I could not find a single Bible. We have Bibles for all kinds of purposes. Like if you go online and you look for a Bible, you can get women's Bibles and men's Bibles and devotional Bibles and study Bibles and all manner of kid Bibles. You can get, Bibles for people who have had all kinds of experiences. But it's interesting, I could not find a Bible for grandparents. And so I've decided that I'm going to write a Bible for grandparents and get rich and retire. Because it'd be the only one out there. I don't know. Couldn't find one. But we were able to find a book that specifically highlights stories in the scripture of grandparents, of them caring for their grandkids and the way that families fit together and the challenges, and that gives biblical input into grandparenting. And your generosity provides for that for these families in our community. So I want to thank you. Those will be finalized today and then dropped off over at the school either Monday or Tuesday. And so thank you so much for that. Want you to be aware this afternoon at 4:00, we're going to be coming back together for a carol sing. Our choir is going to be presenting some numbers. We've invited the other North Central Collective churches, and so we hope that there will be a healthy group to sing in the season. We're asking you to bring some cookies for just a time of coffee and cookie downstairs following that time. That is 4:00 today, and so we want to invite you back for that. And then Friday evening, as I've mentioned already, is our candlelight Christmas service. We hope that you'll be here for that, 5:00 again. And it's just a beautiful service of music and brief message to just remind us as we head into the next day of how wonderful it is to know that Christ has come, and how life-changing that is and has been for us and can be for those that you might bring along. I want you to be aware of, finally, just a couple of things. If you haven't already, we still have some of these little Right Now Media cards that you can drop in your Christmas cards. How many of you are late? If you're a Christmas card person, you're late with your Christmas cards, hasn't happened yet. You don't have to, rhetorical. You don't have to embarrass yourself. But yeah, grab some of these and put them in there. It's wonderful. It's a free gift, and it's going to be a blessing to them. And also, out in the commons, we want to just mention, if you didn't notice, we had a little snow. It was disappointing to me personally. It wasn't ample. It was just crusty and, yeah, it wasn't much. But from time to time, due to the weather, we do need to adjust the schedule. Please use this form, this one right here, that's out at the giving station in the commons. Put your information on there if you need to update it. If you're not a part of that system or on our email list, please give us that information so that we can make sure you're aware of the things that are going on here at Bethany. Well, let me invite up Deacon Al Bump. He's going to lead us in prayer this morning, share a couple of updates with you. It is good to see each and every one of you. God bless you as you head into this week and as we look at the Word together this morning, as we look at the shepherds. Al?
Good morning. It's good to see each and every one of you this morning. A lot of things going on. We don't need to live in fear because we are all part of a Christian family and we know where we're going. So first off, we need to praise God for being brothers and sisters in Christ. We need to praise Him for that constantly. We need to praise God for all of us here at Bethany. I mean, every time I stand up here, you know, it's just so good to see each and every one of you, new faces, familiar faces. Just praise God that we're all here together to worship. Ronnie Crocker, Carol Dunn's son, returned home on December 14th. He's out of quarantine. He had COVID double pneumonia, but he seems to be doing better. So praise God for that. Praise for Rosie, who's heading to Honduras on December 29th. Praise that she's able to go down there, but also prayer for her for safe travels and that she can visit her family, but also that God uses her as a gospel outreach. Praise for all of those recovering from COVID, but also we have a lot of members of our church family that are suffering from COVID, so please pray for healing. We need to pray for the Lord's help that He uses us as missionaries here in the Gardner community, as always. We need to pray for revival here in this church and in the Gardner community in the United States. Please pray that we have annual meeting time coming up. The nominating committee has met for the first time, and some of you will be spoken to participate in our church life through various committees. So please pray that God speaks to those who will be spoken to. It's a tough road to hoe, but it's always good to serve here in the church. Jody Heimela, who's experiencing an MS flare-up, please pray for her. Pray for Jody's mother, who's hospitalized with COVID-related pneumonia. As well as her father and brother are also recovering from COVID. So please pray for the Heimela family. Michael Crocker, Carol Dunn's son, had an appointment with a surgeon on December 16th. He's in a lot of pain, so please continue to keep him in prayer. Ginny Shepherdston, who's very weak and is on oxygen 100% of the time, she's been approved for hospice care. And that's Carrie Novak's mother. So please keep Carrie and her family in prayer. Our missionary of the month, Kurt Erickson, please continue to pray for his mission, but also pray that he finds new housing accommodation. And as usual, please continue to pray for the Zaza people and that the God's chosen missionaries are able to reach that people group. So please join me. Heavenly Father, we're grateful that you've seen fit to draw us to belief in the salvation that's found through your living Son, Jesus Christ. We're grateful to be here, to have brothers and sisters in Christ to lean on. We're grateful that we don't have to feel fear because you're with us. Your Holy Spirit is in our heart. Lord, we're grateful that as a church family, we're able to bear one another's burdens. And Lord, if it be your will, we ask that you please reach out to those who have burdens this morning and help us as a church family to bear them. We're grateful that you've healed Ronnie Crocker from COVID, double pneumonia. Lord, and we ask that you please continue to work in his life through the power of your Spirit. We ask, Lord, that you please continue to heal those that are currently recovering from COVID. We praise you for our sister in Christ, Rosie, who's headed to Honduras on an outreach trip. And we also, Lord, ask that you please prosper her outreach, make her a minister of the gospel, but also give her time to visit her family. And we also ask for traveling mercies, Lord. We lift up our church. We hope, Lord, that you make our church a missionary church. Help us to be salt and light in our community. Help us through our outreach ministries to reach those people that are suffering physically, spiritually. Help us to comfort those around us. Help us to be ministers of the gospel here in Gardner. We lift up our ministries, especially Kingdom Kids and the college and youth ministries, Lord, and we ask that you, first of all, continue to strengthen the workers who work in those ministries. And we also ask that you use those ministries to spread your gospel to those who need it most. Lord, we ask that you speak to brothers and sisters here in this church as we look to find people to fill vacancies in many of our committees and in our church offices. We lift up the Heimela family, who is currently experiencing significant effects from COVID. We lift up Jody. We ask, Lord, that you please continue to help her deal with her MS. We lift up Jody's mother, Ruth Silva, who's hospitalized and struggling with COVID-related pneumonia. Lord, we ask that you please be with her and comfort her and heal her. We're grateful for the healing power you've demonstrated in her father and brother, Tony and Jude, but please comfort the entire Heimela family as they go through this COVID emergency. Lord, we lift up Carrie Novak and her family and her, as she tries to care for her mother, Ginny Shepherdston, who's currently been approved for hospice. Lord, please continue to strengthen that family through the power of your Spirit. If it be your will, Lord, please heal Ginny. And we ask, Lord, that you please continue to keep her close. We lift up our missionary of the month, Kurt Erickson. We're grateful for his mission. We ask that, Lord, that you please continue to work through him. And we also ask that you help him to find a new place to live. Father, we lift up the Zaza people. We ask, Lord, that you please continue to use your missionaries to penetrate that people group. Please convert them and touch their hearts and turn them from their unbelief. Lord, please use us as a means of your grace to spark a revival here at Bethany. Lord, we ask that you use us to spark a revival here in Gardner. And Lord, we humbly beg you for a revival, another great awakening here in the United States of America. We pray these things in your Son's most holy name. Amen.
Let me invite you to take out your message guide this morning, and you can follow along with us as we turn our attention to the Word. And we are in this series for Advent that we're just calling Still. And again, we're trying to connect it back to our series, and in fact, well, our theme for the year, which is more than conquerors. The idea being, you know, conquerors are always action people, and they're, but sometimes you can be a conqueror and just be still and allow God to speak to you. Be still, the psalmist says in Psalm 46, verse 10, and know that I am God. We do our part, but then there comes a time when we're still, and we allow God to do his part, and only what only he can do. And so we're focusing on those ideas during the Christmas story. One thing that I didn't know if you knew, and this may come as a surprise to you, but that's okay, is that every invitation requires a response. Did you realize that? That when you receive an invitation, there's a response that is required. There's an answer that needs to be given. And, you know, sometimes that's wanting, you know. Have you ever, you know, oh boy, I really don't want to tell the person no, but I really don't want to have that moment with them where it gets awkward when I say no. So maybe if I just act like the invitation never came, when in reality it did, then we can kind of avoid that. Can you imagine if you're married here this morning, guy, you got down on your knee and there was that moment when you finally decided to pop the question and you gave the invitation, you opened your heart, you just threw it all out there, and there was no response? Ooh, tough. When Debbie and I were dating and I decided we got to the place where we knew God wanted us to be together, I was like, where should I do this? Where should I pop the question? You know, and everybody tries to come up with some twist on it, you know, the ring is frozen in an ice cube and their iced tea, or, you know, it's, you know, something like that, you know, something weird. And so the coolest place that I know of growing up is the Jersey Shore, is going to the beach. Spent basically every summer of my growing up days at the beach in New Jersey. And so the sunrise at the beach, whether you're fishing or you're just combing the beach to see what washed up during the night, is just the coolest, one of the coolest places to me. So Debbie and I drove up from school to her parents. Her parents knew that I was going to pop the question that weekend. And then we drove up to New Jersey to, you know, my parents' house. And we were there for the weekend. And so we decided, man, I said, wouldn't it be cool if we could just see the sunrise at the beach, you know, kind of thing, you know? And, yeah, sure, you know, kind of thing. So we took a blanket and stuff like that, and we're sitting there on the beach, and you know, we're just, you know, and it was a little chilly because it was late September, October, you know, and the, you know, and we were just, whew, it was a little cold, and so I was just like, it's coming, you know, eventually. And so then I pulled out the ring and the sun's coming up and everything, and it's like, oh, it's that moment, you know. And I said, you know, I'm like that, all right, you know. And so then what would it have been like for me to drive all that way and for all of this and everything, and then to be there on the beach and the sun comes up and, oh, you know, all of this stuff, and then, you know, the and no answer. What would it have been like? Well, she answered and she was like, oh, yes, forever, and you know, kind of thing. And, you know, and it's, you know, it, I was going to say it seems like forever, but it hasn't. But it hasn't. It really hasn't. It's been just an incredible blessing that she accepted my invitation. And the Lord's just been, it's been a blessing for us. And you know, the scriptures, the Bible is filled with invitations. The scriptures and God's word provides invitations all over the place that we need to respond to. It calls us to things, to live in a particular way and to embrace Jesus in our lives and in our journey. And there's a response that is required to those invitations and to his word. And so this morning, I want us to see an invitation that was given and a response that was given as we see it in the story and in the events surrounding the shepherds. Now, we're going to be in Luke chapter 2 this morning, so if you have a Bible, you can use that. Scriptures are going to be on the screen. You can use your Bible. You can take the Bible out of the seats there with you. It's page 905. And the story of the shepherds as it relates to the Christmas story is really found in Luke chapter 2 and beginning in verse 8 and working its way down to verse 20. It's interesting that the different gospels, those that include the birth of Christ, include different aspects of the Christmas story. For instance, when you look at Matthew, you might notice that the Christmas story there only records the wise men, but Luke doesn't record the wise men, it actually just records the shepherds. And so in these verses 8 through 20, we have the appearing of the angels. Verses 8 to 14 of Luke chapter 2 is kind of that introductory material. And lo, they're out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night, shepherds. And then what? And, the angels appear to them, and the glory of the Lord showed round about them, and they're sore afraid. And then we reach verse 15. And we see that the angels give, they have delivered this message, and verse 15, the response comes to the invitation, if you would. And I want us to see today, and this is our basic, our today's transforming truth, the obedience of lowly shepherds is an example that we should follow in our everyday lives. Our theme for this morning is to obey, is to do what the Lord leads us to do and what he tells us that we ought to do. And here we have these lowly shepherds, and they receive this incredible invitation, this announcement. And it kind of brings us to wonder, why in the world did these guys get this news? How did they end up getting the the announcement of the century? How did they end up being the ones? These are kind of smelly, they're shepherds, they hang out in the fields, they're not regularly cleaning up. Sheep are not, they're a little funky. And here are these guys, and they're the ones who receive this amazing news. Now, the shepherds figure prominently in the scriptures. If you haven't noticed, it's what would be called a motif, relates to the idea of a theme, a repeated image, if you would. And so often we speak of, in terms of scripture, motifs or pictures that we see repeatedly, that things that God uses over and over again to speak to particular issues and to things that he uses. And shepherds are one of those things. And they're used in rich and varied ways. Here's a couple of them for you. Shepherds in the scriptures, well, the first thing that we see is that God is seen as a shepherd. We know in scripture that God himself is presented as a shepherd, is pictured as a shepherd. We see that in Psalm 23, and this is, again, one of the most famous passages of scripture, certainly one of the most famous, if not the most famous, psalm. And it says this, it says, "The Lord," speaking of God, "is my shepherd." He is my shepherd. Over in another psalm, if you look a little bit further in the book of Psalms, you're going to see this, Psalm 80, verse 1. "Give ear, O shepherd of Israel," speaking of God, "you who lead Joseph like a flock, you who dwell between the cherubim, shine forth." And so God is presented as a shepherd. We see that picture given of God being a shepherd, a protector, a provider, a leader of his people. But then we also see in scripture another shepherd, and this is Jesus. Christ is seen as, and he presents himself as, the good shepherd. The good shepherd. We see that over in John chapter 10, which is a passage, particularly the first part of that chapter, really dedicated to the whole idea of Jesus being a shepherd and a leader for us. Look in John chapter 10. This is verse 11 and 14. It says, I am the good shepherd, Jesus speaking of himself. The good shepherd, Jesus gives his life for the sheep. And he's, what is he doing? He's foreshadowing his gift of his life on the cross for us. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and am known by my own. He's the good shepherd. Hebrews 13, verse 20. As Paul brings this book to a close, it's a wonderful benediction. We're actually going to share in it this morning. But he says this, he says, now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, that what? Great shepherd of the sheep. The great shepherd of the sheep. So we have God as a shepherd, we have Jesus as this good shepherd, but then we also see that many prominent Old Testament individuals were shepherds by trade or by life. And if you start in the beginning of Genesis and you work your way through, you're going to see a number of them are shepherds. You're going to go back and you can see in the very beginning of the book of Genesis, you see Cain and Abel. Abel is a what? Abel is a shepherd. And Cain is he grows fruits and vegetables. And it caused conflict between the two of them. But Abel is a shepherd. Isaac is a shepherd. We know that Jacob is a shepherd. Moses, for a period of his life, was a shepherd with his father-in-law, with Jethro. We know that David, King David, was a shepherd. And so there are a number of these prominent and important Old Testament people who are shepherds. So why is it that Jesus chooses these shepherds? Now, Scripture really doesn't say why he chose to deliver this amazing news and to give these shepherds this incredible invitation to come and see the Christ child. But we can speculate a couple of things that I want to suggest for you. First, we see the Scripture tells us that God is no respecter of persons. That God doesn't look at the person who works with their hands any different than the person who works with their minds, if you would. But God doesn't view the person who has much different than he views the person who has little. He doesn't view the person who sins much versus the person who sins little, because we are all sinners and any sin separates us from God. And so we know that he is not a respecter of people. And the Scripture that you already saw from Romans chapter 2 is that there's no partiality with God. He doesn't separate us into categories like that. And so we see here that the shepherds, this lowest strata, if you would, of society, perhaps it's just to show that he doesn't respect people, you know, and many times put them into boxes like we often do. He doesn't play favorites. There's another thought that came to my mind, and it's this: God really honors those who work well. God honors hard work. He honors hard work. We see in the Scriptures that God desires for us to work, you know, and if we don't work, it doesn't necessarily go well for us. Those that don't work, if you don't work, you shouldn't eat. How are you going to eat if you don't work? How are you going to make money to have food if you're not working? The importance of work. Over in Proverbs 31, it speaks of the woman, the virtuous woman. And we see in Proverbs 31, 27, it says, she watches over the ways of her house, does not eat the bread of what? Idleness. She works hard. She takes care of the things of her house. Her husband works hard. And it says in Proverbs 31 that he's praised in the gates because of his wife, because she is that kind of a woman. Paul speaks to the issue of working hard in Ephesians chapter 4. It's not a verse that I've included here. But in Ephesians chapter 4, where he begins to tell us all of the things that are the benefits, if you would, of the work of Christ, that he talks, if you would, the walk of the Christian, Ephesians chapter 4, one of the things that he talks about is that those of us who steal shouldn't steal any longer. We shouldn't steal any longer. Rather, we should work. And And when we work, when we are faithful, when we are doing the things that God wants us to do, we know blessing. And it says, in fact, the person who doesn't steal any longer, but works with his hands, works hard, has not only enough for himself, but also to give to others. And so perhaps it's because these guys were just hard workers. And they knew the virtue of work, that the Lord opens the door for them to be the ones who receive this amazing invitation, this good news. Another thought is this, is that God chooses the humble to inherit the kingdom. One of the things that we know is true is that the shepherds were on the humble layer of society. Didn't have a lot. They weren't coming home to a home each evening. Their home was many times the cold ground, or the entrance to a cave, or a sheltered area where they would put the sheep in and then form with their own bodies the gate to keep their sheep safe. The shepherds were humble men. And perhaps it's simply because they were humble in Matthew chapter 5. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the humble. Blessed are those who are just simple, have a simple spirit, because the kingdom of heaven is theirs. So there's a number of reasons why it could be. Perhaps it's enough to just say it completely fits. It completely fits. Have you noticed that God rarely does stuff that makes a whole lot of sense? Now understand what I'm saying by that. Everything that God does fits completely into his plan, but it doesn't necessarily fit into how we think the plan should work. Why would you do that? Why that direction? Why that person? And we sit there and we scratch our heads and we say, what? But God knows exactly what he is doing, and more often than not, it is not necessarily lined up with what we think he ought to do. So who would we think ought to get this amazing message that the king has come? Well, of course, other kings and other leaders and other dignitaries and those other nobles and stuff like that. But no, just in keeping with the way God works, he puts the King of Kings in a stable. He doesn't put him in a royal residence. He doesn't put him in a cushy bed with fine linens. What does he do? He puts him in a manger. In a feeding trough. He doesn't make the announcement and invite people to come see him who are royalty. What does he do? He invites the humble, the lowly shepherds to come and to be a part of this amazing happening. And so here they are, these shepherds who receive good tidings of great joy. And it's interesting, good tidings of great joy. It's the word that's used for good news. It's the word for the evangel. It's the word for gospel. To think about it, here are these shepherds, and they received the gospel, the good news that Christ had come, the King had come, the Messiah was here. And so it was that they got this announcement and this invitation. And their initial response in the first part of that, of chapter 2 of the book of Luke is fear and awe and excitement. Wow. Can you imagine what it would have been like if I'm sitting there on the beach with my bride-to-be, hopeful bride-to-be, and she looked at the ring and she said, wow. Ooh. And that was kind of it. There wasn't any next step kind of thing. Oh, that would have been, oh. Maybe she was fearful. Maybe she was, oh my stars, what is it going to be like to spend, oh, I don't know. But here are these shepherds, and they get this invitation, and there's this response to the invitation, and it's verses 15 down through 20. And I want us to see this morning, again, in keeping with our themes each week, some truths and some tensions that grow out of these truths. So there are three this morning, three ways in which the shepherds responded to what God had invited them to. If you would, it's the response to the invitation. And the first thing I want us to see is this, is that going is an appropriate response to God's work. Going is an appropriate response to God's work. And we see this in verse 15 and 16 in that little passage. And so it says, it was then when the angels had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds said to one another, let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Going is an appropriate response. Often in Scripture, we see this kind of response with regard to the invitation of God. Go back into the Old Testament, Genesis 22. God comes and he meets with his servant Abraham, and he says, I want you to take your son, Isaac, your only son, I want you to take him to the mountain, and I want you to sacrifice him there. And if you read the entirety of the story in Genesis 22, you see that Abraham doesn't say, wow, this is really tough. And so let me spend a week, kind of a last week of just hanging out with my kid. No, he doesn't do that. But he goes right away. He takes off and takes his son. He packs up and they leave the next morning. Very similar fashion, the shepherds, what? It says, let us go now. Let us go now and see this thing which the Lord has made known to us. He didn't wait, but they went. When I was in college, there was a famous preacher, you may know who this person is, you may not, but Dr. Stephen Olford was the pastor for many years of Calvary Baptist Church in New York City. And Stephen Olford was a shorter man, but he was large in stature. And he had an accent, and you know everybody likes people that have accents. And you could just listen to him, and he was an amazing preacher. And he came to speak at the school, and he was along in years at that point. And he was part of our kind of like our spiritual emphasis week. And so each day he was building on this whole theme of going and sharing the gospel. And he was very much an evangelist. And so Stephen Olford, finally he gets to this place and one evening, and he's like, go and share the gospel. And he's in Matthew 28, and you know what? Go and make disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teach them all that I've commanded you. I'm with you always. And he's up there, and their hands are flying, and this little man, and I mean, he was small of stature. There wasn't much of him showing from behind the pulpit. So every once in a while, there were arms would come out, and you knew that that was the moment to be like, woo. So he preached this amazing message, and I can remember going back to the dorm, and we were just kind of like, hair was blown back. We were just shell-shocked. And the next morning we got up and there's like this talk in the cafeteria. Well, something's happened. So I'm kind of like, what happened? So it turns out some of these guys like really took him seriously. And so during the night, some of the guys packed up and he just took off. Let us go see now what the Lord has done. Go and take your son now, go to the mountain. And they took off. And it took them like a day to find these guys. And they were out at some little small podunk. Yes, I can take that from over by Spencer. You know where Sturbridge and Spencer are, Podunk Road? That's actually where that whole idea of podunk came from. I go past it every time we drive it to New Jersey. But they went to some podunk town in the middle of nowhere, and they were on street corners preaching the gospel and stuff like that. They went, they took off. Going is an appropriate response to God's invitation in our lives. He doesn't want us to wait. He wants us to move to action. And so, like the shepherds and like Abraham, these students took off and the shepherds responded to God's call. What are some of the things? They first noticed that they went at the right time. Their going was at the right time. They didn't wait. They didn't kind of hold out to see what was going to happen. It says now. It says, so they hurried. Let us go now and see this thing that the Lord has come to pass. And it says, and they came with haste. They hurried. In what would have been said in their day, maybe they burned sandal. You know, we burn rubber, right? These guys burned sandal. And they took off and they wanted to see this thing. They went at the right time, which was right away. How many of you look back on your life, and I know I do this at times, and you know there were things that God was leading to you to do, there were invitations in your life that got impressed on your heart, and then all of a sudden you found that you stood back and you didn't go at that moment, and then you found, you know what, you just never got around to it. You ever heard this saying, tomorrow letters never get written? And sometimes it's the truth in our life spiritually that those things and those impressions that God has laid on our life that he wants us to do and where he wants us to go, those invitations he's given to us, that sometimes when we don't respond right away in the right time, it just never happens. Going is the appropriate response, and we go at the right time. They go at the right time. Where did they also? They also went to the right place. Notice they didn't say, hey, wow, you know what? It'd be great to get out of this cave for tonight. Let's go and hang out in the city. Let's just get out of here, you know, and just let's find a warm place to spend the night. Let's get a shower, you know. Jacob, you're a little ripe over there. Well, Samuel, you're pretty ripe too. You know, they went to the right place. They went to Bethlehem, the city of David. They didn't go in the opposite direction. They didn't run away like Jonah. Jonah did what? Jonah's invitation to from God was to what? To go to Nineveh. And he says, no, I'm out of here, boy. I'm heading the other direction. No, they went to the right place. But then also, they went with the right spirit. You don't only have to go at the right time and to the right place. You have to go with the right spirit. They went to see the thing that had come to pass that the Lord had made known to them. They went with the right spirit. And so it was when they got there, they found the babe. They discovered him. And the word there is they found him. It's the idea of discovering after diligent search. It wasn't as if they just entered, you know, King of Kings in their shepherdly GPS, and it took them directly to the... Didn't happen. They had to find this guy. There was no... And so the diligent going is an appropriate response. And here's the tension that comes out of that. Faith versus faithlessness. When God gives you an invitation, there's this moment when you either step into it or you don't. You're either going to respond by faith to what he's called you to, or you're going to kind of live in this world of faithlessness where I don't trust enough, or I don't trust him, or I don't trust myself, or I don't trust that he's going to provide and give me strength. I don't know that he's going to give me what I need to enter into this moment. And so when this invitation comes, there's this tension that happens. I sit there on the beach, and all of a sudden there's this tension that happens after the question. Do I trust him? Do I trust him? Now, I don't know that, Debbie, actually, but we have that when we're asked. Knowingly or unknowingly, can I do this? Will I be faithful? Or will there be this moment of faithlessness? Trust me, God is always faithful. He never calls you to anything that he doesn't provide for you, that he doesn't lead you. When you're faithful to listen to him and enter into what he has for you, he walks with you and his presence goes with you. Going is the appropriate response. Let me share a little bit more with regard to this here. From Luke chapter 24, a little bit later on, this is where the ladies have gone to the tomb, and it says they returned from the tomb and told these things to the 11 and to all the rest, to Mary Magdalene and Joanna, Mary the mother of James, the other women with them, who told these things to the apostles. And so here was this, they found this out, and there was this invitation, come and see what the Lord has done. And all of a sudden it says, and their words seemed like idle tales, they did not believe them. Didn't believe them. So what will your response be to the invitation going? It'll be the right place, the right time, the right spirit. But there will be that moment where our faith is tested. Will we respond in faith, or will we be faithless in that moment? Got to move on. Sharing is the second response. Truth number two, sharing is an appropriate response to God's work. Sharing is an appropriate response. And so in verse 17, we see this. It says, now when they had seen him, they get there and they find this babe wrapped in the cloths in the manger, just as the Lord had said. When they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. All who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary, she kept these things and pondered them in her heart. Sharing is an appropriate, the response of the shepherds was, golly, man, you got to come and see this. I got to tell you what happened to us. We were out in the fields and all of a sudden the lights and the choir and everything and the angels, and we got up and we just took off. And we looked and we looked and we looked and then we found it, and it was just like they said. One of the first things that when somebody comes to Christ, they ought to be doing, sharing their faith. At least to somebody. At least to somebody to share the decision and the thing that God's done in their life. Why is that? Because we reach this tension there where we either choose to share or we live in silence. Can you imagine what would have happened if the shepherds chose to be silent rather than to share what they experienced? Sharing is the appropriate response when God works. There's no reason when someone's asked you to give a testimony that there shouldn't be 50 things that they share. Or that when you're in a group and you say, let's share testimonies, what's God been doing in your life? That people aren't like, whoa, you know, the hands are flying. The chair recognizes this person, that way. Everybody ought to have something to share. Why? Because God's at work. If we're in the Word, he's always inviting us into what he's doing. And when we go, when we enter into it, there's an amazing testimony that we can give. God has done something great. And it's our opportunity to stand up and to raise our hand and to share. And just like the shepherds found, what? The people marveled. Wow. These are people that we've said before who hadn't heard that God had spoken, that God hadn't worked, had been absent from their presence for hundreds of years. And now all of a sudden something was beginning to happen. So the shepherds choose obedience and they choose to go, they choose to share rather than to live in this silence. What did they share? How did they share it? Well, the first thing that we know about how they shared was this, that what they shared and how they shared it widespread. They didn't, if you would, they didn't pick and choose who they shared the good news with. They didn't say, well, I don't know if that person really was going to want to hear what we have to say. Let's move on. Ever do that? I'm not so sure they're ready to hear. I'm going to share with somebody else. It was widespread. They made known abroad the good news that was given to them. They made widely known. They didn't hide it. They shared it with anybody that they met. They didn't, if you would, hide their light under the bushel. Here's the picture, if you would, that happens. We have the light and we put it under the bushel. We cover the whole thing so the light doesn't shine in any direction. But some of us who get bold enough and say we do want to share our faith, what do? We kind of like go from bushel to reflector. So we reflect the light in one direction, but we don't let the light go in other directions. You know what I'm saying? Widespread. Anybody they met, that's they just told. You're not going to believe this. This is what happened. They made it known abroad, widely known, what the Lord had done. Second thing we know about it, it wasn't only widespread, but it was true to fact. They didn't embellish it. They didn't have to add a little bit of a, oh, you know, this and wow, that and trust me. Trust me. The truth of God in Christ is great enough, amazing enough, big enough, astounding enough, marvelous enough, that you don't need to add one single thing for it to change somebody's life. All you have to do is just be faithful to tell the story. to just share how God worked in your life. You say, oh, well, I don't this, I don't that. Oh, it wasn't big. I didn't want. Trust me. If you're able to share when you met Christ and something that Christ is doing in your life recently, last week, the last 2 weeks, today, that's enough. But it needs to be true to fact. Because it says what? It says that they made known to the people the saying which was told them. It was no frills, it was no wrapping, if you would, it was just the facts, ma'am, and that's what they gave. And people were astounded by it. Don't need any more than that. You don't need any more. And it was then what? It was impressive. The people marveled. The people marveled. They marveled at these things because the gospel is marvelous. It's wonderful. It's wonderful. So, truth number three. We've got to close this out. Going is an appropriate response. These shepherds went in response to this invitation. Sharing in response, it was exactly the way that they had received the news, and they went and they shared it, and it was true to fact, and it was amazing, and people marveled. They were impressed. Let me suggest thirdly and finally, rejoicing is an appropriate response to God's word. Not only do you go, and not only do you share it, but you know what? Let me tell you what. When God moves and he makes an invitation and leads you and you respond appropriately and you open yourself up to it, you are going to do, you're going to do the spiritual happy dance. Because rejoicing is a response. It's going to change your heart. It's going to be amazing to you. It says in verse 20, the final verse of this section, it says, the shepherds returned glorifying, praising God for the things that they had heard and seen as it was told them. God is always true to his word. Always. What they had seen and what they had experienced and what they had known was exactly the way that they had heard it from the angels, and they rejoiced. Their hearts were overflowing with joy. How great our joy. Great our joy. Joy, joy, joy. Joy, joy, joy. Praise be the Lord in heaven on high, because it was exactly the way that God had said. And they overflowed with joy. Overflowed with joy. You see, we can take moments of celebration with regard to what God's doing. Or if you would, we can, the Lord married to ponder these things. But many times, God's desire for us is to have celebration. Sometimes, you know, we sit there and we're like, let me think about this. I have to process this. But these guys didn't say, oh, I got to think about it. After, I got to sit down and I need to have a few evenings under the stars to just kind of ruminate on this. No, they just were ecstatic from the get-go. And God did something amazing. They did not return the same way that they came. They didn't return the same way that they came. And they returned with a spirit of celebration, not just, wow, that was something. You ever met somebody that just seemed like, I have no idea what it's going to take to get this guy or this girl excited about anything? Just met that person who's just kind of like, and you're like, hand me the paddles. Got to do something. Got to do something. God, do something. Out in the field, angels appeared. God spoke to them. And it was a spiritual shock that took them from the mundane of the evening to something that was amazing. And what they experienced, they shared with those that were around them. They went right away in response to what they saw. And the people that they shared it with were amazed themselves. And it led them to celebrate and to glorify God's good work. They rejoiced. Let me ask you this. Will you be like the shepherds? The shepherds obeyed and responded to God's invitation. And for all of us, let me just say the call is the same. It's the same. God's desire is for us to go. And to do it at the right time, to the right place, and to have that right heart spirit. God desires for us to obey and to respond by sharing his work with others. That good news of great joy. That's for all people. Share it widespread. And don't be grinchly. Celebrate. Celebrate the joy that we have in Christ, that God has worked and he's spoken and he's done great things. What has God done in your life? What is a great thing? What's the invitation that he's given to you? Act on it, move into it, step into it. Follow the example of the shepherds. Father, we thank you for this morning. And we praise you and we thank you for the example of the shepherds. And Lord, I can't help but think that, Lord, there's none of us here who are royalty. There's none of us here who are noble. Yet, Lord, in your wisdom, you've spoken to all of us. Led us to your Son. And so, Lord, we pray and we ask that you would help us as the shepherds to respond appropriately. Help us, God, we would pray, to go where we need to go, where you're leading us, to share what you're doing in our lives and to rejoice at the good thing that you're doing. What a wonderful time of year, God, that we are able to do this. Hearts are open, particularly during the Christmas time. Help us, Lord, to use those opportunities. Help us to be as the humble shepherds. Thank you for the good tidings of great joy that are ours. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together and sing, What Child Is This?
Thank you so much for being here today at Bethany, and we hope that you'll come back this afternoon to enjoy singing more carols of the season and to hear the choir share in music. That's 4 o'clock with fellowship time afterwards. And then again, do not forget Candlelight Christmas Eve, 5 o'clock on Friday evening. Should be a wonderful time of music and message. Please come back for that also. Join us in the cafe, if you would, for coffee and a little bite to eat. And Next Step groups will meet at about 11:35. So if you'd like to stay and enter into discussion, love to have you. Our benediction today, again, from Hebrews chapter 13, Paul speaking with regard to shepherds. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, may he equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. God bless you as you go. We'll see you.